All right. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
In her book, To the Table, Lisa Graham McMinn writes, "Eating is a humble reminder that we are not, after all, autonomous beings. We are interdependent." My name is Gail Lindsay Marriner. I use she, her pronouns, and I have the great privilege of being the minister here at UU Santa Fe. This morning, we are exploring our deep interdependence with the rest of the world through the lens of food and eating. We have two UU Santa Fe member friends as guests this morning, Nate Downey, water-wise guru and aquaponics grower, and Kirsten Hansen, who coordinates getting fresh, healthy food from our local growers to people in need through a number of very cool programs where she works with the farmers markets. Mike Owens is the worship associate this morning. Lydia Madrick is on piano. Ron Tintner is our guest musician. He is with the acoustic musicians on Barcelona, and they are playing this evening at 7 o'clock right here. It's a wonderful way to spend a Sunday night and launch a week. There is a town hall about the canvas and the budget after the service straight across the way in the fellowship hall. There is a free thinkers gathering here at noon in Fogelson. The free thinkers are hosting Nick Fish from the American Atheists. It's one of those usually busy Sundays here at UU Santa Fe. Our opening song this morning is in the gray book. It's number 38. It's an old standby, "Morning Has Broken." Please rise as you are willing and able. Wear a mask if you would like to sing. We're protecting some of our immunocompromised friends and family members. If you want to just listen, you can also just listen. Please rise as you're willing and able. Please be seated. Just so you know, for most Unitarian Universalists, life, God, and earth are frequently synonyms. Hold that in mind when you're singing and you bump into one that doesn't match your particular theology some morning. Life, earth, and God scan exactly the same. It works. And it gives us a little more space instead of putting us in a place of resistance. Our opening words this morning are adapted and rearranged from a piece called Food for the Spirit. It goes like this. I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Here is the food of life, food for the spirit. Let all who hunger come and eat. Here is the water of life poured out for us. Let all who thirst now come and drink. We come to share this food. We come to share this water. We come to share this love. We come to be restored in the love of all and made new as an instrument of that love. We know that we are worthy, and we know that we are welcome. May we never praise ourselves while denying in our hearts or by our acts food or drink or love to others, because all are worthy and all are welcome. Come into the embrace and remembrance of this communion. Jim, I need you to put your headset on because I'm getting a feedback. There we go. Thank you. Yeah. There we go. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And now we're going to light the chalice.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Mike Owens. My pronouns are he and him. For those of you watching online, if you will light your chalices at home as we light ours here. May this flame we light remind us that every one of us can bring the light of love into the world. May this flame be a symbol that every heart can burn bright with joy, peace, and harmony. May the wisdom of the ages speak to us through this flame and stay in us. Every one of us can be a blessing to the world.
All right. So, like every other living thing on this planet, we humans are dependent on other living things for our own life and well-being. Even plants, with their miraculous ability to turn minerals and sunlight into sugars through that ritual called photosynthesis, even plants require other plants. They live in complex webs of fungi and bacteria and other microorganisms in an intricate and interdependent dance. All of us have to eat. None of us can thrive without the entire web of relationships between those other living things on the planet. That web of relationships which cleans the water and filters the air and enriches the soil that supports the plants that provide the food for us and for the other things, the other creatures which we eat. And it's not a one-way flow where energy flows from the rest of the cosmos into us. It's more of a give and take. Because each thing that we do as human beings, each choice that we make about what to eat and where to live and what to wear and how to travel, influences the health of the soil, the cleanliness of the air, the purity of the water, and the ability of the creatures who share this planet with us to thrive. In her book, To the Table, Quaker author Lisa Graham McMinn comments, quote, "All Earth's members depend on being able to sup from a global table that offers good water, clean air, and fertile soil chock full of life. For our own well-being, then, we need to tend the well-being of the whole." Now, while we know up here that we are interdependent with all the living things on the planet, and while we can see a little more easily that our actions here in New Mexico touch the health and well-being of every organism that lives downstream from us, our interdependence is often easiest to see when we pay attention to the most proximate and local of things, like the food that we put in our mouths several times a day. When we eat fresh food from local growers, those interconnections are easier to map than when we eat processed, what Pollan calls processed food-like substances, manufactured far, far away and shipped around the globe. When we eat local cuisines featuring foods that are in season in our particular place, we weave ourselves into the local landscape and watershed and culture in a way that cultivates our appreciation for the richness of the land and the ingenuity and care of the growers and ranchers and cooks and the people who taught them their craft and the land that sustains them and us. I don't know how many of you have tried to grow vegetables here in Santa Fe, but if you have, you know what a challenge it can be. Our sun here in the Mountain West is intense. The air and the land are dry, and the creatures who share this place with us, the mice, the rabbits, the pack rats, the gophers, the birds, and the deer. Did you know we have a flock, a herd of deer right here on Barcelona? I've come across about 9 of them several evenings in the last month right here on our UU Santa Fe property and between us and Old Pecos Trail at the top of the hill. Who knew? Anyway, all those creatures are hungry and thirsty, and anything that looks juicy and green is exactly what they're looking for. Growing food here in New Mexico is not a matter of turning over the soil, scattering a few seeds, and waiting for the rain. Doesn't work that way. Even here in the city, you're going to need a fence. You're going to need an irrigation strategy. And it really helps if you have locally adapted plants. And even when you have those things, growing anything that you can eat takes time and attention. It takes effort and expertise. I don't know about you, but I would find it absolutely overwhelming to try and feed my family from my garden and my greenhouse. It means that we are all more interdependent than we like to admit. As I was preparing this service, I came across a 2012 lecture by Wendell Berry titled, "It All Turns on Affection." His thesis in the lecture is that the kind of mutuality needed to sustain health and well-being in an interdependent web is grounded in a deep affection for place and for community. He says that health and well-being requires a deep respect and affection and fondness for our neighbors, for the land, for the animals and plants that we eat. Without affection for people and place, the temptation is to focus on profit. When we focus on profit, either as individuals or as corporations, then we can't connect to the beings or the landscape in front of us, because we are compelled to extract as much as possible on our way to somewhere else. The antidote to such selfishness, says Berry, is affection, neighborliness, the willingness to actually get to know our place in our place, the willingness to fall in love with this place, the willingness to recognize all the people around us as neighbors and to be neighborly with them, the willingness to choose to eat and shop in ways that will not only sustain our well-being, but will support the well-being of the rest of this interdependent web. Now, Nate and Kirsten are some of our neighbors, and they are connected to and neighborly with a number of our other neighbors that many of us haven't been introduced to yet. They are part of the web of people who provide healthy local food here in Santa Fe. If you listen, you will hear their deep affection for this place and for the people who are a part of it when they speak a little later in the service. When Nate talks about his experience as a grower in that part of our local food web, and Kirsten talks about getting food from the growers to folks who need to eat it. For now, though, I'd like you to hold on to just two ideas. First, that we directly experience our interdependence with our neighbors and our planet in the food we eat. And second, that treating all living things in our interdependent web with the respect and affection we owe to our neighbors is a good way to ensure that all of us will thrive. Let's see, where's Ron? There he is. Ron's first song is titled Love is Everything.
The stones in our chalice are reminders of truths that we strive to keep in mind. The first is that the land where we live and worship, called Intewa Ogopoge, has been home to many peoples down through the millennium, and we must act to keep it a good home for the peoples who will come after us. The second is that the ongoing violence in the world rends the minds and hearts and bodies of people all over. And we must act to diminish this suffering by working for justice and peace. The third is that climate change, driven in large part by human activity, is a grave threat to the global ecosystem that sustains us. And we must act to undo the damage we have done by living sustainably on our Earth. May it be so.
So we set aside a time every Sunday morning for the sharing of sorrows and of joys, in part because we know that sorrows shared are easier to carry, and in part because we know that joys shared are multiplied. Last week I did a reading about ouches and oops, and after the service I got my first ouch. It turns out I overlooked a couple of the joys that people wanted shared. So I am sharing them first this morning. First, Andrea writes, Easter Sunday was Transgender Day of Visibility, and her sorrow, she says, is that there is state legislative persecution of trans people rampant in our country, and it's causing terrible suffering. History shows us that such persecution expands to include group after group and typically ends very badly. Trans rights are human rights, and community inclusion is vital. And a joy. My adult child, who identifies as trans non-binary, turns 23 next week, graduated from UNM College of Fine Arts last December, magna cum laude, just got a job in community education and outreach at the Transgender Resource Center of New Mexico, and has a good, safe living situation, and we have a joyful, loving relationship. There are belated birthdays that need to go out to Bill Austin, Jim Leary, and Cheryl Fossum Graham, all of whom had birthdays last week. And later this month, George Simon will celebrate his 90th birthday. There's a card for him in the foyer. Please sign it on your way out this morning. We have a note from Tencha Avila. She says, Aloha from Melalina, Kano, Hawaii, where I was a guest at the hilltop home of one of my junior high students from 60 years ago. Melalina is the word for heavenly in Hawaii, in Hawaiian, and so it was. All right, so now Mary Nykirk sent in a joy this morning, saying after her recent stay in the hospital, she is feeling much better, and thank you for all the cards and well wishes people sent last week. Healing thoughts to Judy Tuff. Judy and Jim and Jen are new to UU Santa Fe and will be back as soon as Judy is feeling better. Dominique Mazot has a joy for us. She is celebrating 1 year at UU Santa Fe, first attending April 16th of 2023 and joining soon after in May. She writes, wow, a church celebrating the earth and all beings on it. We have a warm welcome to Justin Garut, who signed our membership book this morning. Welcome, Justin. Where are you? There you are, right in the back. Good to have you with us. Leona just texted a joy. She said she is deeply grateful to the doctors and medical systems in Bellingham, Washington, and in British Columbia, Canada. They have coordinated a chemo regimen for her daughter-in-law, which allows her to access different treatments in both countries in a coordinated way. And it looks like it's a life-saving combination. She is grateful to everyone who made that possible. All right. And then we have visitors today. If you're a visitor and you are feeling extroverted in this moment, you're welcome to wave. If you are a visitor and you are feeling introverted, you don't have to, but we're still going to look around and try and say good morning and welcome after the service. Our visitors today are Carol Whitney, Nick Fish, Joanne Holliday, Margaret Roberts, Zoe Upshaw, Monica Garut, and Linda and Frank Dukes. We are so glad that you are all with us today. It is a joy. So if we could, and Mike's on it, light one more candle for the joys and sorrows we have not yet shared, and for those we carry in the silent recesses of our hearts. Now, if you would, holding these sorrows and joys, let's sing Spirit of Life. It's 1, 2, 3 in the hymnal if you need the words. Or you can just follow along as I sign. So, as we move into our time of meditation this morning, we have little paper cups filled with mint leaves for you. And Nate and Kirsten and Michael are going to bring them through the congregation. And we invite you each to take a little paper cup. The mint leaves are from the Marriner family's greenhouse. I can guarantee that they are clean and pesticide-free, and I invite you to take them and hold them in your hand as we move into the meditation. Nick Min writes that we move toward intention when we do some sleuthing and then make informed decisions about the food we purchase. We move toward attention when we slow down and engage those in whose presence we are eating. And we move towards gratitude through the simple act of saying grace before a meal and thank you afterwards. The grace she offers spoke to me. To the web of life that feeds us, we bow our heads in gratitude and awe. And so now I invite you to take a breath and to center yourself, to close your eyes and let your body relax. Let your thoughts drift. Feel your heart soften and open. Breathe. And draw your attention to that small green leaf in the little paper cup. Take it between your fingers and notice its texture. Notice its color, its early spring perfection. Bring it to your nose and notice its fragrance, strong and bright. Rub it between your fingers to release more of the essential oils and notice how the scent gets stronger. Breathe. And if you like, go ahead and place a little piece of that leaf, or maybe the whole leaf, on your tongue. Notice how the texture is different in your mouth than it was between your fingers. Notice the flavor. Does it match the fragrance? I'm always a little bit surprised how savory a mint leaf is. It isn't sweet, and I sometimes always expect sweetness to accompany the fragrance of the mint. As you taste the leaf or inhale its fragrance, I invite you to taste or smell the things that gave that little leaf life. Each leaf is soil and water and sunlight, sheltered from the coldest winter storms and the drying spring winds, tended and watered by caring hands, and carried here this morning to remind us of the many ways we participate in the ways Earth feeds us. These leaves are shared to remind us of the many different ways we, in turn, feed each other with words, with actions, with fond looks and mint leaves, with affection and attention, presence and generosity. Breathe, my friends. We end with Mary Oliver, who writes, "How calmly, as though it were an ordinary thing, we eat the blessed earth. How calmly, as if it were an ordinary thing, we eat the blessed earth."
Hi, everybody. Thank you for getting here on time, 10:30. I think back to when the congregation was trying to figure out when to do the service, and it actually had a lot to do with my kids' lacrosse practice at noon, and we had to get it out of here by 11:30 in order to make lacrosse practice. I also think it helps after the service if folks want to go out and get some food for lunch to beat the crowds. It's always good to get out there before everybody else at noon. So I just got back from New York City, where I grew up, and I got to see my mom and dad, and that was wonderful. And it's actually back for a memorial service of a coach from the old days at the relatively privileged school that I went to, private school in New York City. I shouldn't say relatively privileged, it was privileged. And Mr. Trouth, who we went back to celebrate, made sure that The students at that school understood that they were privileged and that there's a serious responsibility associated with that. And I wanted to go back and honor him. And as I did, it got me thinking about the first grade nativity play that Mr. Trout had nothing to do with, but Ms. McKinley and whoever was the other teacher had a total of 45 or more students to put in a nativity play. And you got, you know, the donkeys and the sheep and all that, and you get the three kings and you know, the stars of the show and everything. But fortunately for me, they created the merchants, the three merchants, and I was the third merchant. And my line was, because we all had to go back to the Holy Land and back to our cities to be taxed, of course. And, you know, on this potentially not cusp of a major war out in that area, I was a little merchant saying, I have fetched a pitcher of water from the well, so we shall not be thirsty. And I think I had one other line, but that was the extent of my experience at the Nativity play as a performer. But that line kind of, I think, stuck with me. And years later, I was still at the same school and actually editor of the newspaper, which came out three times a year. and there was a big drought in New York City. If you can go Google it, it's probably the 80s or 81. And I wrote the editorial about water conservation, and I was very concerned about water conservation. None of the grown-ups were. I mean, you saw it on the news, and there was this thing, and, well, you know, what were we going to do if, you know, 17 million people had to leave the tri-state area? Fortunately, it started raining, and I don't know why, but New York has not experienced a drought, to my knowledge, since then. But I did write that editorial, and I was actually quite disheartened by the reaction that the grown-ups had to such a serious problem. Fast forward to my boarding school, where I wrote the editorial supporting Gary Hart for president. Oh, good. Everyone remembers Gary. I snuck that editorial in without permission, so I was kind of excited that we endorsed him. I was just the arts editor at the time, but I knew how to cut and paste. Physically, we had this X-Acto knife and everything, and got it in there. And so, but Hart was really all about innovation, about smart ways to reform things. And he also inspired the youth with his ecological stances as well. But that chapter in my life led to some despair because it came crashing down quite quickly, thanks to actually a few people whose names we still know. Paul Manafort and Roger Stone and Lee Atwater were involved in the taking down of that sort of unjust act. But I wasn't going to go work for the administration. I had to figure out a place to go to college. And so I was no longer working for Gary's campaign when it came crashing down. And I found myself coming over the Raton Pass with the biggest rainstorm that I'd ever experienced. You know, probably still top five or six. And I was on my way to St. John's College. And I'm really glad that I ended up here, and I'm really glad that Gail brought up the notion of interdependence. In Plato's Republic, which we study early on at St. John's College, there's this notion that no man is an island, that we are interdependent, and that perhaps if we're going to learn about what the virtuous soul is, there's just a quick step to understand that, we would look at what the shape of justice, we might say, for a city might be. And so in book four of the Republic, we're going along nicely, and Glaucon and the other interlocutors are having a nice little chat with Socrates, and they say, hold on, Socrates, wait, our perfect city, it's gonna have to have salsa. It's gonna have to have relish. And Socrates says, oh, he doesn't say it so quickly. But by a few chapters later, you realize that that decision to have food prepared, stored as a resource for later, that might be delicious, that might be something you have to protect, leads us to a fascist state, which is what the Republic ends up being. The perfect state is quite regimented. And so, graduated from St. John's and discovered permaculture, where you could grow your own food and produce your own energy locally, and you didn't even need politics anymore. And that was so great for a few months. I realized that, you know, in order to have chickens, I had to have some permission, and in order to have a cistern, we had to get Tom Udall, who was Attorney General at the time, to rule in a certain way, and he ruled in a certain way, and we got to have cisterns on residential properties of 5 residences or fewer without a permit from the state. And that was exciting. And speaking of permaculture, I can't be standing here and not refer to Gail's wonderful first sermon when she was thumping a book at this pulpit and said, you know, this permaculture stuff is pretty cool. She had a permaculture book in her
Gaia's Garden.
And so Melissa and I were sitting in the second row, and we're actually in the book, and we decided to join at that time. But the politics did come in, and we got active. When I say we, my wife Melissa and I met in the library here on a Tuesday evening at a Green Party meeting. And I don't know if anybody here was around in the early 90s in this place, but in this city, we had 2 city councilors and 2 and a municipal judge, all Green Party people, thanks to the activism that actually started in that library there. And that was a very important part of my life, and it's an important part of where I'm headed here. Ultimately, Melissa ran for county commission and lost by 250 votes. And I ran for city council and lost by way more, fortunately, because we have a great city councilor up there now, Carol Merrill Worth, is who I lost to. And I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today, so I'm very excited. Which brings us back to water and food and permaculture and growing food in the desert, and what is food? And if we think about that problem that occurred in the 4th book of the Republic with certain kinds of food being things you have to store and that you have to protect them, and perhaps even the allegory of the Adam and Eve story with that apple, which is not a wild fruit, it's agriculture. What are the implications of food systems? And I learned quickly what Gail described earlier, which was that it's very hard to grow food here. You know, and 97% of the food we grow in New Mexico goes out of state, often in the form of alfalfa, which has actually become cow's milk and cheese and ends up on your frozen pizza, 1 out of every 100 frozen pizzas. But so the food thing was important to my company at the time, Santa Fe Permaculture, but it really became about water harvesting. And harvesting water in cisterns and swales and French drains and pumice wicks and building compost and storing water in soil. And that was wonderful and great and inspiring, but it really wasn't going to feed us. And so I heard about this guy named Charlie Schultz, who was studying aquaponics. He wasn't studying aquaponics. He had been studying aquaponics since the early 90s, and he was teaching aquaponics at the Santa Fe Community College. And because I was the sort of water guy, I needed to learn about aquaponics too. And within a week, I realized I was going to change my career. I was no longer going to be an ecological landscaper and talk so much about cisterns and harvesting the rain. I was going to talk about recycling the rain, because what's really exciting about aquaponics, if you're trying to grow food in the desert, is that the water recycles. You feed fish in an aquaponic system. They excrete waste, and bacteria and fungi and algae are in there and help with the conversion of wastes into nutrients for plants that then take those nutrients up and clean the water so that it can go back to the fish. And so I have no idea what Socrates would say to that. It's pretty amazing. It's on that little sheet going around. You can learn all about it at the community college next Saturday from 10 till 1. There's an open house with a lot of aquaponic systems. There's also hydroponic systems there. Now, hydroponic systems don't have the fish. They have, you harvest the salts of the earth by mining them, or you take those from the earth that you've mined and then commit a sort of atrocious process called the hyperbrush process, which of course feeds the world, but it also creates the fertilizers and burns a lot of carbon to do so. So you end up in our modern system of food, whether it be hydroponics, whether it be out in the field, burning a lot of carbon just to get the fertilizers that you need to grow. Two more minutes, no problem. So aquaponics gives me hope because it does have that recirculating system. And the Santa Fe Community College really gives me hope. They also have an algae program there where it looks as if algae might be able to take the waste that comes from a hydroponic system and convert that into some kind of product. Then you would be able to essentially have a recirculating hydroponic system as well. But we're not there yet. The yield of any permaculture system is unlimited, and it really just depends on the designer. In our case, we're going to be distribute when I get my greenhouse built and I have a building permit and we'll be breaking ground soon, we'll be distributing in a very neighborly fashion. And we will be working with 50 neighbors in a neighborhood and delivering to them on one day and then going to the next neighborhood the next day and the next neighborhood the next day until we come back to that first neighborhood 2 weeks later in a very communal way. And we'll also be working with communities and schools. We'll also be working with Santa Fe Mutual Aid with extra food we have. And what's really exciting about this new delivery model that I have is that we'll be able to also deliver other foods from the farmers of northern New Mexico. So we'll be this farm-to-home concept based on aquaponics really bridges a lot of socioeconomic gaps that we have as well. It brings food and people together. It brings students to care more about getting back into farming, which is a real problem in our country and in most countries. But what might be most exciting, and it's a segue into Kirsten's talk, is that if we have the anchor crop from the aquaponic system, we should be, and deliver that, we should be able to diversify our offerings and support the other farmers of northern New Mexico with a very exciting food distribution model. So I think the concept of interdependence and respect that Gail talked about is really, really important. And In respect to all of you, I want you to know that you're all going to get a head of lettuce, whether it comes from this basket or some of the coolers out front. And just rinse it before you eat it, and keep it in your car with maybe the window rolled a little bit down when you go to have your lunch, so it doesn't burn up in there, and it'll be delicious. It was harvested maybe six miles from here a couple days ago. Thank you.
Thanks, Nate. I look forward to putting food in your distribution network. I'm Kirsten Hansen, and I thought I would be remiss if I wanted to talk about local food and interconnectedness if I didn't tell you that I am connected to Elizabeth Swope at the back of the room there. She's my mother. And I thought I'd tell you about the time Elizabeth went full hippie. She and my father raised us Unitarian Universalist, but we were raised in New England. And somewhere around 1972, I think, I'm a little hazy because I was barely aware of time at that point, our little church in Sherbourne, Massachusetts, decided to go full-blown hippie. Everybody else was, so the New Englanders were going to catch up. And my mom and my dad and several other young families from that congregation actually started a huge vegetable garden on donated land, and we spent a couple seasons out there sort of in community after church on Sundays and on Saturdays, all growing food together, harvesting food together. I have a really, really dim memory of my mother baking bread, like whole wheat bread. That interlude lasted a few years. We weren't the best of hippies, but we had a good time. And I will always be grateful to her and to my dad for raising us in that kind of a community that would let you all raise food together and enjoy food together and sit down and eat it together as well. What I do, however, is on a larger scale than just that simple garden that I think a lot of us have experienced and maybe is our first connection to truly local food. I work for the New Mexico Farmers Marketing Association. And most people immediately realize, oh, they work with farmers markets. And we do. Our founders came to this work hoping to provide sustainable markets for small local growers in New Mexico. And the most obvious way to do that was to start and support farmers markets. But because it is difficult to grow food here, and because when we say small farmer, we mean small farmers. For most of our history in New Mexico, very small communities have fed themselves and done it very well. Just a reminder that we are surrounded by our neighbors on the Pueblo lands who have been growing food here since time immemorial and who continue to grow food rather quietly without a whole lot of flash. And a lot of the food that they do produce in their communities stays within their communities and is used not only to feed their communities but also in service of their rituals and ceremony. They go so far as several of the Pueblos have entire bison herds that they also use in those ways. And then, of course, we have farm after farm, if you drive up to Taos, farm after farm after farm that were established some 400 years ago through the land grants. And those families have also stayed connected to the land. So when somebody like me comes in and says, I work for the New Mexico Farmers Marketing Association, I'm not just thinking about supporting farmers markets. In the back of my mind, it's always how do we maintain that connection to place and land and community and keep us all connected. So yeah, we do farmers markets. And farmers markets, most people who come to Unitarian Universalist Church probably really like the farmers markets. They feel good, they're fun, the food is amazing, there's music, there's good coffee. But maybe they're not for everyone. And we came as an organization to realize that they really weren't for everyone. Because at least the perception is that in order to eat locally, you really have to have some pretty deep pockets. I think we all have that experience of our $3 tomato, right? And that's simply because it costs a lot to grow in this environment. Nobody's getting rich at the farmers market. Nobody's getting rich in any of the other programs I'm about to describe. And so one of the things we decided we could do as an organization and as a community of farmers was to help make the markets more accessible to folks who didn't necessarily have those deep pockets. So we jumped on board when the USDA started opening up some funding and have been running a program for about 10 years, and this is part of the good news, all the good stuff that's happening in New Mexico around local food. And the number one thing is our program called Double Up Food Bucks. Double Up, simply put, is the way for folks who are on SNAP, what we used to call food stamps, gives them access to farmers markets. The concept is you come to the market, you swipe that EBT card. Let's say you take $10 off your monthly allowance from the government. The program we run then gives you $10 to spend for free on fruits and vegetables at the market. So you get your $10 off your SNAP card to spend on meat or eggs or dairy or honey, and you get $10 for free to spend on fruits and vegetables. And that's one of the ways we've attempted to make the markets more inclusive and really work for everyone. And it's been really successful. We're a small state, and so our numbers are small, but we reach thousands of consumers every year, and millions of dollars go through that pipeline, and they stay in the community. So when you're using your SNAP card, you're not sending it off to Walmart. The money's going back into the pockets of local growers, and that feels really good. And it gives the local growers a chance to connect to folks in their communities they might not otherwise connect to. How many of you have ever been told you should eat healthier?
Right.
I think all of us have been told we should eat healthier, and that's where my program comes in. It's a sister program to that Double Up Food Bucks. I run what we call a produce prescription program, and it really comes out of that impetus we all have to eat healthier and a recognition that not everybody can afford to eat healthier, even if you swipe your EBT card. And so in tandem with Double Up Food Bucks, the USDA has made some monies available so that doctors and other providers can basically write a prescription and send you to the farmer's market, which is a whole lot more fun than Walgreens. And the way it works specifically here in our community, for the most part, I work with what we call federally qualified health centers. Those are the places like La Familia. Those are the places serving folks who may or may not have insurance, who may or may not be here legally. And providers there, if they diagnose somebody with, say, diabetes or another condition for which we've all been told to eat healthier, instead of just handing them the prescription for insulin or metformin, these folks are also getting vouchers that they take to the farmer's market. And these vouchers give them free fruits and vegetables for the growing season. We've been able to expand that statewide, and we're really pretty proud of it. We also have begun working with Pueblo communities because, to be honest, as bad as the diabetes problem is in New Mexico in general, it's even worse in Indian country. So we have a sort of a sister program where I work with a grower from San Felipe Pueblo, and he grows as much as he can in his space there. And then he also buys from other farmers all over New Mexico and brings together enough food to create 320 bags a week during the growing season. And through a very complicated series of distribution networks, we get the food out to the Pueblos and to some of the folks facing some of those challenges. And my organization holds both of these programs and really is very committed to making sure that local food is for all of us and not just for those of us with deep pockets. There's a lot of other good stuff going on. I'll go over really quickly. Nate's kind of part of the new thinking and a new way of doing agriculture in New Mexico. We kind of hang out a lot with the folks who are doing it the way they've always done it. We all get together. We all realize our enemy is Walmart, not one another. We strive to really support one another. And I feel like our state government gets it. And they're trying to support us as well. So I wanted to elevate that real briefly. And some of the ways our state is elevating local food and some of the efforts that we have been championing include the new Universal School Meals Initiative, where every child in a school that participates in a federal lunch program, and there are private schools that do that as well, will be eligible for free lunch and breakfast regardless of their household income. We're trying to break down those barriers. What has that got to do with local food? The governor's office realized local should be a component of those lunches and breakfasts. So we have created an entire program aimed at providing local food to school systems in a safe way and to senior centers for those lunches that seniors go and eat, and local food to early childhood centers. And lately, there's been a real effort to also get local food into our food banks so that some of those great salsa ingredients are also getting out to folks using food banks and food pantries. That entire umbrella is called New Mexico Grown, and I hope it's something you'll be hearing more about as the years progress. Another thing that is happening, sort of awareness on the state level, includes the support that more and more of this whole idea of how do we get the food to the people from these really small farmers. The farms are so small in New Mexico that they don't have their own refrigerated vans. They don't have cold storage. They don't have a lot of that infrastructure that even medium-sized farms have. And so our solution in New Mexico has been what we call food hubs. And they've kind of arisen organically to address the needs of different communities. And we're at the point now where we realize we need these food hubs who are buying the products from the small local farmers, bringing them together, and then distributing them to institutions like the schools, like the senior centers. But these food hubs need some support as well. So we're spearheading a project to help these various food hubs from places like Silver City or Las Cruces or the South Valley all start to sort of coordinate and work together. This sounds very capitalistic, to rationalize those distribution networks, right? But it's really meant to ultimately support those small farmers and to support these efforts to get good, healthy local food to the senior centers, to the schools, maybe to the hospitals, you know, all these places that want to buy 5,000 pounds of potatoes rather than the 40 that a local farmer might grow. So I want to leave you today with that message that there's a lot of really good stuff happening. Keep your eyes open when you're reading the newspaper or, you know, listening to the news. If you are approached by one of us asking for help to sort of put a little pressure on a state legislator or the governor's office to do the right thing, I hope that you can think back on today and remember that you can support these programs. And then I hope tonight when you're, you know, falling asleep that you'll envision Elizabeth Swope as a hippie. Thanks, everyone.
So we are winding down now, friends, just a few more minutes. There are, with every hymnal, a copy of the New Mexico Harvest Calendar from Farmers Markets New Mexico. Kirsten sent these to us. If you know, need, if there aren't enough to go around and you want one, let me know. We can make more copies. We also have a little list with that called A Few Things You Can Do. And it's got contact information for the Earth Day events up at the Community College and St. John's and some other suggestions. We have out in the foyer, I think, 10 copies of Green American, which is a periodical Jean Darling brought to us. This particular one is called Is Your Money Working for a Greener World? You might want one of those to get inspired. And then I am to give you two announcements. First, if you want to get your hands in the dirt, this Wednesday, April 17th, we're meeting early in the morning here at UU Santa Fe to wash windows and clean up the grounds. We've got 8 of us signed up. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. Roberta would like to know how many donuts she needs to buy, so please sign up. The second piece that I'm supposed to share with you is our pledge update. 114 pledges are in. We still need pledges from 57 additional pledge units. We hope who pledged last year. We hope a few of you who haven't pledged before will also pledge. The amount pledged to date is 58% of our goal, so we've gotten $206,582 pledged. In order to budget, we need to get your pledges soon, and Roberta's going to be at the pledge table and can help you with information and forms after the service. We are blessed to be an interdependent community filled with a myriad of resources. We share what we have in order to support one another. So with those words, we're going to pass the offering baskets. So Mike and I don't know who else, someone else, please grab the baskets and let's pass them through the room. And Lydia has a little music. Oh, is Lydia still here? Nope. Okay. Let's pass the baskets and then we will go on to our chalice out, our hand-holding benediction. And I think, Ron, don't you have another song? Yeah. All right, let's have you do Central Park right now. That's right, you're here, Central Park. And then we'll do chalice and the benediction. Thank you. Lots of moving pieces.
Test. Is it on? Yeah.
Hey, cabbie, give me a ride. I'm going crazy, cooped up inside. Little space, I feel alright. Take me to Central Park. Take me to Central. Take me to Central. Take me to Central Park. Hope you don't need directions. Take me to Central Park. Stroll through gardens, garden fields, around the reservoir, cool your heels. Dig the zoo, the lions and seals, they're all down Central Park. Take a jog, just couple of miles, watch dogs chase frisbees for a little while. Pretzel and coke, sit back and smile. Take me to Central Park. Take me to Central, take me to Central, take me to Central Park. I'm moving through the forest, higher and more. Take me to Central Park. Hey, cabbie. Take me to Central Park. Take me to Central Park. in the traffic and get there free. Drop me off from East and Six. Take me to Central Park. Yeah, take me to Central. Take me to Central. Take me to Central Park. I'm moving further than forwards.
Our time together is finished, but our work is not done. May our spirits be renewed and our resolve strengthened as we meet the challenges of the week to come. This chalice flame is extinguished until we ignite it again with the spark of our communion.
All right, if you would reach out and grab hands with someone sitting near you. We're going to do our hand-holding benediction. I'm going to ask you to sit down again afterwards, because we're going to send the lettuce out into the room during our last song. May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us. As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, namaste, blessed be. Assalamu alaikum, ashe, aho. Okay, and if you will sit, we have a world premiere of Ron's newest song composed for the occasion. We have three baskets of lettuce going out through the room. If you do not get a lettuce from the basket, it's okay. We've got coolers full of additional lettuces out in the courtyard. They're out of the sun, actually. So, all right, take it away.
In honor of this occasion, this new proposal is called The Garden of Eden. Been a long, cold winter. Now the sun is warmed up the dirt. Blossoms are blazing in yellows and reds. Green leaves caressing the earth. We planted lots of good stuff, tended with love and with care. The seedlings we sowed have decided to grow, and we got lots of bounty to share. Up, down, round and round, a garden of Eden sprung from the ground. Now we partake of the fruit, and we make that our garden will be table bound. Apples and onions in the air, broccoli and Brussels sprouts, turnips, tomatoes, peas and potatoes. Funny how these things work out. Up, down, round and round, a garden of Eden sprung from the ground. Now we partake of the fruits we make, and our garden will be table bound. Happens every year, but it's still amazing. These wonders happen. Never take it for granted. We're happy it happens this way. We're thankful and glad for all that we've had, and hope it keeps happening day after day. Up, down, round and round, a garden of Eden we have sprung from the ground. Now we partake of the fruits that we make, and our garden we can take it back. Table bound. God, you be taking you down.
Thank you for joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.